everyone. Welcome to today's Pet Pawcast. I'm your host, Dr. Roberta Westbrook. It's been such a wonderful year here at the Houston SPCA, the campus for all animals. I'm so glad to be able to speak with you guys every week and hopefully give you some helpful tips for you and your furry family members. So again, thank you for joining us. And we've got some exciting news for you today. We're just going to do a short little discussion today about all that the Houston SPCA has accomplished this year and all we're going to be looking forward to in the future, and how we are so thankful for you guys who have been supportive of us this year and how you can help us do an even better job next year. We're so grateful to have you as part of our family. So if you have any questions, just general questions about what we do, how you can help, please put those in the chat. And let's just have an open, fun discussion today. So until then, I want to introduce you to our pet of the week. Our pet of the week today is Andrea. Andrea is about a one-year-old female. She's spayed. We think she's a pointer mix, and she's a very, very special girl. She's so sweet. Andrea came to us as part of a cruelty case. She had a severe ear infection that has caused her to have some compromise in her hearing. She's essentially deaf. And so we want her to go to a family who has patience, who's willing to work with her. You can certainly train a deaf dog. They can be a wonderful family pet, get along with your children. So she just needs a family who's going to be loving and patient with her. She's a wonderful, wonderful pet. So please come on down and visit with Andrea and all of our other dogs and cats and puppies and kittens, rabbits and guinea pigs that we have available for adoption. We've got a pet that can meet your family needs for sure. So let's get started. It's the end of 2022. We're going into the new year. So excited. And we're just going to tell you a little bit about what we've done so that you know all that the Houston SPCA has done. You know, let's start with adoptions. One of the things that we love about our program here is getting the animals into adoptive homes. We see a lot of animals that come into the Houston SPCA that are sick, that are injured, that are ill, and that are in dire straits. We work very, very hard. This entire organization, it takes the entire team to get these animals healthy and well on their way to finding a new home. And we've done a phenomenal job this year. Our adoptions team is going to make over 9,000 adoptions this year, over 9,000 placements of animals into homes this year. And that's amazing. That is good news for the animals. That's good news for us. And so thank you. If you've adopted a pet from us, we appreciate you. And we thank you for giving of your time and your home to a furry family friend. So adoptions are a big deal for us. You know, another thing that we've done is this year, we had a really successful kitten and puppy nursery. So every year in the springtime, that's kitten season. That's when cats in the community are giving birth. And unfortunately, sometimes for a myriad of reasons, these kittens and sometimes puppies become abandoned on the street. Their parents, their mom is oftentimes, you know, maybe injured or can't care for them. And we take those neonatal puppies and kittens in. This year, we had a really successful kitten nursery. We had more than 600 kittens come through our facility and be either kept in our 24-hour nursery where we had staff bottle feeding kittens and puppies 24 hours a day, or we were able to get these neonates into homes so that they could hand raise these puppies and kittens. It was such a successful year, and we hope that we can continue to provide medical care and hand raising for these puppies and kittens in the future. So those are just two of our accomplishments this year. Do you guys have any other questions about what we've done this year?
All right. So what are your guys' memorable rescues?
Yeah. So, you know, we mentioned the ambulance service. We get animals coming in through our 24-hour ambulance service, a very unique service that the Houston SPCA offers. We have ambulance drivers that take phone calls from the community about injured pets in our community. And our ambulance drivers, who are wonderful people who risk their lives each and every day to save animals and bring them to us, that ambulance team is fantastic. We have done more than 7,000 ambulance rescues this year. And so, you know, it's a wonderful service that we provide for the community. So when we, what was the original question?
Memorable rescue. What's the rescue that come to your mind that are so big?
They do so many things, you know, between the ambulance team. And so, you know, we get lots of injured animals. One in particular that actually did not come in through the ambulance service, but actually came in through our cruelty and investigation service, was a really, really memorable dog who you guys have probably been following recently on social media, named Sharky. Sharky, it was a little puppy that was found with a hair tie around his muzzle. And, you know, and this is a really sad case. Unfortunately, some people may have thought that that was going to be a good way to keep Sharky quiet, or, you know, way, unfortunately, to harm him. And Sharky came in with a hair tie around his muzzle that had been there for likely weeks to months, so much so that it had, you know, worn through all of his skin, all of his soft tissue, it's down to the bone. And it was a really, really serious injury. One of our veterinarians, fabulous veterinarians, Dr. Shipley, was able to do surgery on Sharky and fix the wound in his muzzle that really went all the way around his jaw and get him healthy. You know, that was an amazing case, and it would have been, you know, lots of time, money, effort, and Sharky may have had a worse outcome if he was somewhere else or if our team had not brought him in when they did. So we're very, very grateful that Sharky is completely healed now. We're thankful for our veterinary team for being able to save his life, and for the cruelty and ambulance teams that were able to find him and bring him in. So that's a really memorable one. We also had, just before Sharky, we had a seizure of about 50 small breed dogs. If you guys follow us on social media, you may have seen where we were able to save and rescue about 50 small breed Maltese poodle mixes that were abandoned in a house and, you know, in terrible condition, you know, covered in urine and feces and matted hair coats. You know, they were in pretty serious condition and unsocial. Our veterinary team, our volunteers, people in the community really worked to get those animals healthy, to get them medical care, to get them grooming care. Thank you to the groomers who came out and volunteered their time to get those dogs in comfortable positions to where they didn't have all this matted fur. We thank you for being a part of that. That was a very memorable case because when you have hoarding cases like that, oftentimes the animals have suffered for a long period of time, and to be able to see them make such a dramatic change and eventually find their forever homes really touches our hearts. So those were some of the cases that I remember really in just the last couple of months. And there's so many, the list can go on and on.
And then one last case, you know, the Wildlife Center of Texas is part of us as well. Did they have a big rescue this year?
Absolutely. Houston SPCA's Wildlife Center of Texas is always doing wonderful things to rehabilitate and save native wildlife who are brought to the facility. And so, yes, there was a case where we brought in some egrets whose habitats had been unfortunately destroyed. And so we had egrets, about 71 orphaned egrets and other birds who were brought into the facility to be raised here while they got healthy and were able to be released back into nature. And so, yes, we're always doing wonderful things for the community to save those animals that need us as often as possible.
And then, do you remember our biggest rescue from our cruelty investigations team?
Oh, yes. So you must be talking about, there's so many animals in this case that I don't even have them all memorized. I'll have to try to look it up. It's about 82 animals total. And it included dogs, it included cats, it included, you know, some puppies, guinea pigs.
And a cow.
A cow.
Some pythons.
Two pythons. A baby caiman. A baby caiman. Two horses. A rabbit. I mean, this was 82 animals. I mean, these animals were just in one location, and our cruelty and investigations team was able to bring them into our facility so that we could provide proper habitats, food, water, shelter, housing for these animals so that they could be in proper environments necessary for them to thrive. So that was a wonderful case. They had great outcomes. They're all doing wonderfully right now. So we're always doing great things in the community. So if you notice that there is an animal in your community in need, please don't hesitate to reach out to us. Again, we have a 24-hour rescue ambulance. We also have a cruelty investigations team. Please give us a call at 713-869-7722 or visit our website at HoustonSPCA.org. And there are links there that you can click on to make a loss report for a pet, to contact our cruelty and investigations team so they can investigate cases of potential animal cruelty and save those animals. So you can help us help the animals in our community by being engaged, by reaching out either through phone call or the website, or you know, coming in and reporting things that you see that might be of concern.
With so many rescues that we did, you know, that was just the very tip of the iceberg. You know, what are the biggest expenses, you know, to care for all these rescued animals?
That's such a great question, because we're taking, you know, thousands of animals a year, tens of thousands of animals a year. And it does cost money to be able to do that. And we thank everyone, every person who is given in any way to help us do that, time, money, you know, donations, whatever you can give. But we have a lot of costs, and because of the types of animals that we see, predominantly we see sick and injured animals, most of our cost goes toward veterinary care, because the animals that come to us oftentimes have very severe injuries and illnesses, and it takes, you know, days, weeks, months sometimes to rehabilitate these animals and eventually get them to a place where they can go to a forever home. So veterinary care is overwhelmingly, you know, the biggest cost that we have to be able to do that. So whenever you donate, please know that you are helping us directly to get these animals healthy. You know, our ambulance drivers and our cruelty investigators travel over, you know, close to 200,000 miles a year just to go out into the community, find the animals, bring them in to us. And that takes maintenance on the cars, that is gas for those vehicles to travel. And so your donation dollars can help save animals through keeping our cars maintenance up to date, providing gas, providing medical care, providing actual medication and treatments. You know, it, not a penny goes to waste, and we appreciate everyone who is given in that way. If you can't give in the way of financial or monetary donations, please don't think that you can't help and be a part of our team. There are so many other ways that you can give. One of those major ways is giving time, is becoming a volunteer. We could not do what we do without the time and efforts and dedications to our volunteers, both at the Houston SPCA and at the Wildlife Center of Texas. We have dedicated volunteers who come here on a daily basis. And what can you do as a volunteer? There's so much that you can do. One of the things that our animals benefit from regularly is just interaction with people. Just going on a walk, having those hugs, having those pets, having that one-on-one time with another person. These things are wonderful for the pets, for their mental well-being, and not only their mental well-being, but you know how much it touches your own heart and how good it makes you feel when you're cuddling a puppy or a kitten, or you're spending time, or you're having lunch sitting outside with a dog by your side. It does us good for our health and does the animals good as well. So becoming a volunteer, you can spend time with the pets. You can help to walk them. You can help in the Wildlife Center of Texas if you have some experience there with rehabilitating wildlife, helping do laundry, helping to, you know, wash instruments in our surgery suite and recover patients. There is so much that you can do as a volunteer. All you have to do is go to HoustonSPCA.org, click on the tab that says volunteer, and you can talk to our volunteer coordinator and our staff, and they can get you set up in the department that works best for you.
Yeah, that's so great that you talked about that, because, you know, we're starting a new year, so we're trying to see how else we can give back and what we can do different, especially to help our rescued pets. And something else to do if we can't volunteer time or money is, like, educate. So what are, like, two main things that you want everybody to know, you know, telling your friends and family, what, you know, to help the overall population, a problem with Houston, or just to help our rescued pets?
Yes, you know, one thing that's just really important is general. It sounds like something cliche, but really we like to educate the community about responsible pet ownership. And that means a couple of things. One of the main things that we talk about when we talk about responsible pet ownership is the health of the pet. So the health of the pet includes, you know, making sure that pets in your care visit the veterinarian. Make sure they visit the veterinarian on a regular basis, once or twice a year. Keep them current on vaccinations. make sure that they have a microchip. Microchipping, having some permanent form of identification for your pet, is critical to keeping them safe. So many lost pets come to us each year without any sort of identification. No microchip, no collar, no tag. And we know that these animals have a home. Our goal is to get these lost pets back to their families, but it's a very difficult process if there's no identification. So make sure your pet is current on vaccinations, visit the veterinarian, has some form of identification so that we can reunite you in times of separation. And then finally, spaying and neutering pets. A lot of the problem, you know, in Texas and in other southern states, is we have a relative overpopulation of pets in this area. More pets than we have homes for them. One of the ways that we can prevent this overpopulation, we can prevent the stray population, is by spaying and neutering your pets, and not allowing them to mate and give birth without a plan for them to find a home. So talk to your veterinarian if you have questions about spaying and neutering. You know, we can even give you help if you have questions about spaying and neutering. So those are some educational tips that we always want pet owners to be aware of.
And that's great that you mentioned microchips, because we do know New Year's Eve is a big one for, you know, shelters or vets, because that's going to be almost the number one holiday where pets get lost. So how do we ensure that our pet has a microchip and that is registered, and how is that going to help on New Year's?
Absolutely. So, you know, it's great for your pet to have any sort of identification, a collar, a tag with your name, your phone number, so that if you get separated from your pet, we can reunite you. But collars get lost, tags come off. Sometimes the lettering is difficult to read. So a microchip is a permanent form of identification that your pet can have implanted underneath the skin, and your veterinarian can do that. The benefit of a microchip is, in the event that your pet gets lost, if your pet winds up in a veterinary hospital or any animal care facility, any veterinary clinic, emergency clinic, every clinic and hospital has a microchip scanner. A microchip scanner is a tool, an electronic tool, that when you press the button and run the tool along your pet's back and body, it will pick up the microchip information. The microchip number is connected to your personal information, your phone number, your address. And once we trace the number on the microchip and we get your personal information, we can give you a call. We can tell you where your pet is, and make arrangements for you to pick up your pet. So microchipping is a wonderful way to have permanent identification. You know, New Year's Eve is coming up. New Year's Eve is a known holiday for fireworks, and fireworks are known to trigger animals that have anxiety. And so what can happen is when the fireworks go off, sometimes it panics pets and they start to run. Sometimes they will even run through closed doors. They will jump out of windows. They try to escape the noise because of the anxiety. And so there's an increased number in lost pets, usually during times of fireworks like New Year's Eve or the 4th of July. And so these are good times for you to make sure that your pet, one, has a microchip, but two, that the microchip information is up to date. If you're not sure, please call your veterinary office. They can help make sure that your microchip is current and up to date. If you have the microchip information and you know the company of the microchip that your pet has, please give them a call. Make sure the microchip information is up to date. We want to make sure that we can reunite with your pet in the event that that's necessary.
And like you said, so many dogs get so scared during the fireworks. You know, any tips, any general tips on how to help them with anxiety that night?
Sure. So if you know that your pet has anxiety, you know, always keep in contact with your veterinarian so that they can get some medication if necessary to your pet sooner rather than later. So there certainly are some medications to help reduce anxiety during these times where there might be fireworks and a lot of people around. There are medications that you can give. You may want to consider keeping your pet busy and distracted during these times. So that means giving them toys, treats, things to focus on. Maybe putting them in a room with music playing so that it drowns out the sound of the fireworks, or at least it doesn't sound as scary. You can also purchase clothing for your pets, kind of help improve their calmness. For example, thunder shirts, you may have heard of that. Thunder shirts are, you know, tight fitting shirts that you can put on your dog to calm them down. It's kind of like a tight little hug. And it does work in many animals to calm them down during times of anxiety. So it's worth a try if you know that your pet has anxiety and you're trying to figure out what you can do at home with such a short notice before New Year's Eve, how to get them calm for that new year.
All right, we're almost wrapping up the end of the year and the end of the podcast. So what are you looking forward to next year at Houston SPCA?
Yeah, we're always looking forward to doing more and doing better. I mean, we can always make improvements. We can always save more lives. We can always reach out and bring more people into our family. So those are the things we're looking forward to. You know, we want to make sure that we're doing everything we can to increase the number of lives that we save. We want to reduce animal cruelty. We want to educate the public so that we can do our part in making sure that people recognize what animal cruelty is, how to prevent it, how to stop it, how to be responsible pet owners, and how we can help to do that. You know, we're doing more in the community. We're going to be looking forward to working on starting a public serving hospital so that we can help owned pets as well. So we've got a lot on the horizon. Please stay tuned. Please stay plugged in as a part of our family. Visit our website regularly and see how you can become a part of all that we're going to be able to do. So there's volunteering, there's fostering. You can become a foster and help us to save animals by taking a foster into your home. The list is endless about ways that you can become part of our extended family. I can't say thank you enough to all that you've done and all that we are going to do in the future as a team. So thank you guys so much for being with us in 2022. It's been a wonderful year. We are looking forward to a wonderful new year, and we wish you all the best in 2023. Have a wonderful, happy new year, and consider coming on down and visiting our adoption center and maybe taking home a pet for the new year. New pet, new year. Okay, thank you guys so much. It's been wonderful. I'll see you in 2023. I'm your host, Dr. Roberta Westbrook.